current role, round of Johan was VP Johan of Architecture for Shell, where he created and developed the architecture practice across Shell. Well, this session will explore the business challenges that oil and gas...
Okay, still morning, good morning. So we're going to talk about the subsurface space for people who don't know, I don't know who's all in the audience. For the people who don't know what subsurface, of course, is, it's the first beginning of any oil and gas company. So it's the exploration space where you try to go out there shooting seismic. It's the development space where you, once you have hopefully found something you want to develop that field. And it's the well space where you start really getting your production wells in space. That together we call subsurface space. And what we're going to really looking at why we're doing this. Of course, there's a lot of change happening in our industry. We've got, of course, the whole trend towards new energy sources. At the same time, we still have oil and gas, especially gas, for many years to come to really support our demand for energy around the world in a growing population. And of course, which is a bigger impact, is the move to digitalization. And this stage is all about data. I mean, if you talk about this stage, you really talk about data. How do you exploit data? That means that's the whole story around digitalization. That means we have to start working in a very different way. And that's what this is about. How do we make that happen in our industry? So first we're going to talk about the why, scope, the members, current status, and plans for the future. So think about the subsurface space. If you look at that whole space of subsurface, you've got many disciplines, and each of these disciplines have their own applications. And really, the data is owned by these applications. So the problem you have, you've got many silos. So if you look all the way from exploration to the wells environment, you might have several silos of data. And of course, it's very hard then to look at the end-to-end picture. Therefore, the third bullet point, how do you see a view? If you try to drill a well, can you go all the way back to exploration, what really happened? That lineage is very difficult to do today because all that data is linked to the various disciplines. So you've got lots of silos out there. Yeah. So if you really want to be ready for going from a physics world to a machine-driven world, where you really need to bring all the data together and then use that data for fault finding or other things you want to do, you have to bring that data together into a single data platform and move away from those silos where the application drives. So you move to an application-driven world to a data-driven world. And that's what it's all about. It's not unique to the subsurface space. It's also not unique within Shell to subsurface. It's true for the whole of Shell, of course. But here I'm talking particularly about the subsurface space. So you have to move to a world where the data is owned by application data. The data becomes one large data platform. You talk about fairly large environments. So in a typical integrated oil and gas company like ourselves, you talk about maybe 100 petabytes, which goes into a single data platform here. If you look at all the data you're shooting, all the seismic you're shooting, all the other files out there, you become to about that size if you bring it all together. So how are we going to about this? Yeah. So we said, okay, we of course can do this all on our own and try to make this world, and we started already the development, called the SDU, the Subsurface Data Universe. So we started development about a year, 9 months ago. Started developing a data platform, showed in a moment, with the application around it. And we said, well, of course we can do it as Shell on our own, but does that make sense? It's far more important in nowadays market to really try to go to an open source based environment, because the speed of change in open source is many, many times faster than in any proprietary environment. So we said, we looked at it and we said in March we start bringing together other operators, say, hey, can we make this an industry solution? What we're talking about, of course, you talk about, let me first show this picture. So this is really the elements we're talking about. At the bottom, you see, of course, your infrastructure platform. It is all a public cloud environment. We only talk about public cloud. No on-premise unless we need to do like on the left, because we operate in countries where we cannot export the data to other parts of the world. If you look at the bottom, you see the hosting environment, pretty straightforward. The crux of the system is your data platform. Yeah, that's where you store all of your 100 petabytes of data. And of course, there's lots of different data sources over there. It's not all structured data. A lot of it is unstructured data, binary data. It's a whole raft of different data sources. therefore your data ingestion service is so important, because the data ingestion services really extract metadata. If you have a large data platform, you put millions and millions and millions of files in the environment, if you have no metadata, you create yourself a big problem, of course, because all you have lots of data, but you have no information about that data. So therefore, the data ingestion is really about extracting metadata of each file you load in that environment. Yeah, that is a Wells file, a drilling file, we don't really care. You extract metadata, and the metadata you store in a graph database in a data platform. So data ingestion and data platform are the crux of this whole environment. On top of that, you have your business applications, your common applications, your all microservice-driven environment, so your common applications, your individual applications, your orchestration services, and of course your HTML5-based interface, all browser-based environments. Then you've got your information security, but if you're storing large amounts of data, you also have to think about your security model, how to protect that data, because the data will be accessed not just by Shell people, many other parts of the industry as well. Of course, the support environment over there, that really, if you talk about the subserver data universe, that's the picture we're talking about. On the left, as I mentioned, we operate in countries like many oil and gas companies where we're not allowed to export data and bring it to a cloud environment. Therefore, you also have your in-country solution over there. So if you talk about what we try to bring into the open source environment, this environment. So if we, where do US companies differentiate or compete is in the application space. Yeah? So the application space is really where you want will compete between each other, but also with other software companies out there. The rest of the environment, the data platform, the hosting, security, is really very much a common-based environment. So what we try to do is create a reference architecture for this so people can use as the base. We talked about what it covers. It covers the exploration space, the development space, and the well space, and all the data you can think about there. And that's a whole vast array of data, and also increasing real-time data, because increasingly we have sensors in our fields collecting real-time data over the lifetime of that asset. Yeah? And all the services, we talked about it, your data, your storage, your compute, your application platform, etc., is all part of this, the scope we're talking about. And of course, only public cloud-based. So what we try to do now is really to say, okay, how can we make this an industry solution, not just a Shell solution? As I mentioned, we started that exercise in March of this year. We had together about eight operators, and I'll come to the names in a moment, and we're now pursuing this under the umbrella of the Open Group to start a new forum to really drive this as an industry solution, not just for the eight companies out there, but also for any oil and gas company or software companies supplying to this market. Everybody is really can become a member of this new to be established forum. So what are the two things we try to achieve? A common data platform for all exploration, development, and wells data, yeah? And a common platform for development, deployment, and running of applications. So making sure they have a single platform with well-defined APIs, on top of which anybody can develop any type of application and will fit on that platform, whether a platform runs at Shell, or at BP, or at Exxon, or at Chevron, or Devon, or whatever it is. Yeah? So we're creating a market out there which goes beyond a single company. That's the whole purpose over here. Yeah? And then the last point over there, of course, making that as part of an open source environment. But the bottom line is why we're doing this is creating a market out there where people can develop applications against and really compete where we should compete and really use open source where we can use open source. So the layer of APIs of the data platform is essential for people to start developing any type of application on top of that. So the data, as I mentioned, it's really the single data platform. As I mentioned, the data ingestion services, all part of the standard environment, on top of course, a hosting platform, and then the rest application on top. So these are the parties at the moment working this. So these are people, the companies kicking this off together with the Open Group, under the umbrella of the Open Group. And we come together again tomorrow over here to have another face-to-face meeting to talk about the release, the first release, etc. And the formal name is, I think it was on the first slide, but I'm not sure I got on the slide. But the formal name is now the Open Subsurface Data Universe Forum. So that's the formal name will be called. in addition to the other ones over here, but this is then the open subsurface data universe forum. So the focus is, as I mentioned, at the subsurface space, anything in that space. So where are we? Current status. So we had a number of meetings under auspices of the open group to bring together, okay, are we interested? Do we want to do this? Yes, we want to do this. We are finalizing the charter, so the charter is still in draft. We hope to finalize it by next week, July 31st. And then Prince Philip comes in the final charter. And now we're starting to talk about, okay, what will the first release look like to be issued, I would say, late this year, early next year, and how, what will be issued, what are the standards, the APIs, the reference model we're going to issue, et cetera. So the focus now starts moving to a content that were based on the work already done in Shell, but also the work being done in other companies, because as I mentioned, we started this work in Shell about 9 months ago. So that's the kind of material we also will use in this outfit to make sure we have a kickstart in this space. And it's really the last slide. This really wanted to talk about. So to repeat, it really covers the subsurface space. It's really making sure that we bring this whole world to an open source environment. Why? Because we need to have much faster speed of development. And of course, we're moving from a silo-based approach to a data platform-based approach because of the move to a digitization environment driven by machine learning, et cetera. So that's what we're trying to achieve, and that's what's being kicked off more or less today. So thank you much for your attention.
Johan, thank you very much for coming along and explaining what's behind this. And
okay.
Please have a seat. We'll move a microphone or something. So as Johan has said, we have a new forum in the Open Group. Which is great. Always happy to announce those. The organizations involved so far in this have been moving very quickly. What we've seen, and correct me if I'm wrong, but what we've seen is that Shell had a business problem to solve and very, very quickly identified that their problem was probably not unique to Shell, but probably to other operators. The other operators that so far involved have all resonated also with the problem, and
yep.
The idea of pooling resources to try and solve this problem, create a common standard around this, a reference architecture, is what the Open Group does, brings people together to do things like that. So it's a nice fit, and as of today, anyone interested in joining the forum and in participating is able to do so, welcome to do so. Still in the formation stage, as Johan has said, so there are some things to tie up, hoping to get a charter by the end of the month, but it's going to be a new and exciting forum. So first question to ask you is we're starting with operators. What other type of organizations do you think may be interested in membership of here, on the supply side, for example? Or
yeah, so if you look at the operators, you've got all the major IOCs there, but of course there are many other operators out there if you look at the national oil companies. So it's really trying to create a market out there for other parties to develop software or hardware, maybe software for this platform. And it can be software suppliers in this market, it can be universities, it can be academia, it can be anybody who wants a broader platform. Because often we have the problem in the oil and gas industry, they have maybe too many platforms, and often they are very small. And if you really want to survive over, you have to really make that platform much more larger and much more popular. So it's important that you create demand out and create a market out there. In principle, these 8 or 9 companies starting doing that. And of course, when you start creating people developing software for that, you get the chicken and egg story. More software developed, more people to join, more people to join, more software to be developed. That's all about the platform is all about. If you want to survive in today's market, you need to have popular platforms. You can see it all around in industries. So it is all about creating a popular platform in the subsurface space where people want to develop applications for. Those applications can be very small, can be very large. It's really a microservice-driven environment. We have clear frameworks how people can develop for this platform. But it's really, our aim is to create a market out there for people to develop, and that can be any software company, either active today or not active today.
And should be of interest to cloud providers as well, course, as part of it. So a number of questions have come in while you've been speaking, and people are hearing about this for the first time, by and large, in this audience. So will the objective be to create a Google Earth-type functionality for what's under the ground?
Google Earth also includes the application layer. Our first focus, also with Google will be the first focus, is purely creating that data environment, so bringing that data together in the common platform. And of course, on top of that, you can have Google Earth as an application. I mean, search, of course, is a very, that's why I mentioned before, the metadata story, because with metadata, I can enhance my graph environment, I can do my search, because search, in essence, is using metadata story. Yeah, so in principle, Google Earth can be used, but of course, let's be clear, not all the data of every operator will be in one environment. There will still be a shell implementation of this environment, right, an Exxon implementation, or a Chevron implementation of this environment. The intent is not to bring all the data together for every operator into a single large database. It's still a shell. At the end of the day, shell will implement this standard, so will the other parties on the thing. But in each of those environments, yes, you will. What will key over here, and that's why I mentioned the silo, what's key over here, thanks to the metadata, I can see, which we can't do today, if we do something, let's say in Australia, I want to know, do we have a similar structure in other parts of the world, and how would it look like? Today, that's almost impossible to do because of the silos we have. So if I want to now, in this environment, say, okay, I have a problem in Australia, I want to have a certain structure in Australia, where else in the world do we have that? In this environment, we can do that. I can, in principle, look anywhere in the world, what data do I have available, what structure do I have available, and what can I learn from that? Today, that's not something which is really available.
Okay, great. So I think you've answered this question, but it in the negative, which is the plan to have a data platform that actually shares data across companies in an open executable standard?
Over time, that might very well happen. We're open to that, but it's not the way it starts. Right. But also remember, in many cases, because if we talk about ConocoPhillips or Chevron, in one field we compete, in other field we work together. Yeah, because you got often joint ventures where we have maybe 10% ownership and Chevron might have a 20% ownership. So in some of these fields, they will have access to the Shell data or vice versa. Where we don't work together, of course, we only have Shell decides with access. I would expect over time that this data gets more and more generally available to be exposed to people who want to develop and mail type applications for this environment. But that's not where it starts.
Okay. Great question here. What is specific to this architecture for oil and gas? It looks generic enough that it could apply to any industry.
Which is 100% correct. What will be specific to oil and gas is the subsurface space is the wide variety of data source we have, which makes it fairly complex. Because in many industries, the majority of the data is structured type of data, it's relatively straightforward. Here you have many type of unstructured type of data, many different data sources. So that's why I put so much focus on your data ingestion layer. Your data ingestion layer is so important. But apart from, okay, we support file types of subsurface, there's nothing unique about this which is subsurface specific. We deliberately did not do that. Because in principle, we have the same problems in other parts of our industry. What is unique, if you look at the rest of Shell, what's unique here is the many data sources we have and the sheer scale. I mean, we have more data here than the rest of Shell together several times. Yeah. So, but can it be used in, let's say, in the pharmaceutical industry? Yeah, of course it can, yeah.
Right. Which takes us to a question I thought might come up. There seems to be a potential natural intersection between this new forum and the Open Process Automation Forum. Has that been discussed at all in your group?
Well, I look at OPA because we're also an active member of OPA. We're very keen to make sure that OPA is successful, to make sure we're getting some new developments in the process control domain. So we're very keen on that. But we see them as two. You could see that OPAF will feed into this environment because OPAF is really a process control domain. You're collecting data. So is there a link between the two? Yes, there is. But I see OPAF as a feeder into this data platform. And it can be it can be just time series data. It can be other types of data. So yes, in the end of the day, there's always a link because we use both environments in our industry, if assume both are successful.
Okay. Is the drilling real-time in real-time drilling in scope for the forum?
That's why we talked about real-time data. So increasingly, especially in the drilling space, and that's why also, especially in drilling space, you can do so many things there, also with machine learning, how to real-time drive your bit down in the ground. So yes, clearly, the real-time piece is an important piece of this, and the development of the well, where we stop, but that's where we stop today, is once the well is in production, we put into another data platform. But that's really what we defined so far.
Right, and the suggestion here is there may be some real-time APIs coming out of the Open Process Automation Forum.
We'll use on top of the data platform layer then, yeah.
Yeah. How much of the subsurface data is proprietary to the individual companies, and how are you thinking of addressing the risks of defining a common data architecture for a company's proprietary data?
The data might be, because of course, if we shoot seismic, it's our seismic, but the formats are not proprietary. Yeah? So if we ask a company to go into the Gulf of Mexico and shoot seismic in a certain space, and there's Shell data, and there's many petabytes of data, the formats are not proprietary to Shell. So if Exxon would shoot seismic in another part of the Gulf of Mexico, they would use exactly the same formats, of course, all the data, but the same formats. So what counts here are the formats and the data types, not, of course, the data unique to Shell or owned by Shell or owned by Exxon or owned by Devon or owned by somebody else, but the data types are not unique, and therefore my focus all the time on the data ingestion layer, because that's really where the difference will be made.
Okay. Somewhat covered, but a specific question: would the mining industry benefit from this as well?
What I show over here, the data platform, every industry is moving into that space. Because if you look at the rest of Shell, if you go to our retail business, do something similar, yes, but the scale is totally different. It's much and much smaller. It's far more structured data. But mining, where we spoke to one of the mining companies before we started about 9 months ago, in Australia, of course, you have similar data types over there. Yeah, you got similar data. Yes, in principle, you could use exactly the same structures out there. As I mentioned before, it's not unique which says this is subsurface only. Mm. Yeah, what is unique to this? So what is unique is your data types. Therefore, your data ingestion layer, you have your data, because in data ingestion you do data extraction. You open a file. Of course, that file is maybe unique to the data, to the oil and gas industry. But the mining, if they have a data extractor, would fit their own one in. So from what I know, and I'm not an expert on data mining, because we Shell went out of mining many years ago, yes, it will be it will be fairly similar.
Okay. A question here that's probably more for me than you is, can existing members of the open group join this forum, or is there an additional charge? The answer is, this is a new forum, so it's a silver membership activity, so a separate charge in that sense. It is within the gold member entitlement. So for those of you who are gold members, there's no additional charge. That's the answer to that. And platinum, of course, for those platinum members in the room. There are many users of subsurface data. Do you envisage use of the OpenSDW platform in adjacent markets like earthquake tracking and geoscience?
Yeah, it's the same answer, yeah, because... Yeah. Like in the case of Shell, we already have, because people won't know over here, but we have earthquake problems in the Netherlands with one of our larger gas fields over there. We do exactly that, yeah.
Right, yeah. Okay.
Because in the end of the day, we're putting sensors out there, we're collecting the real-time data and try to predict these earthquakes, which are not always successful, but of course you're collecting the same data, yeah.
Right, and that's it for the questions, but there's a general encouragement like we had from Venkat earlier about participating in the... In the working group, any of you who think your organizations might be interested in this, this is just kicking off, still in foundation stage,
yes.
And they'd love to have you participate and help shape this. And I look forward to working with you all and the Open Group staff and the members of this to give it the value that you're hoping to get from coming here.
Yeah.
So, okay. Thank you, Johan.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much. See you again.